The message today is lifeblood. And I've got a whole pile of scriptures that they read on the mail. But I was doing my devotions last week, and I don't know how I got there, but I got into for the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you to make atonement for your souls upon the altar. For it is the blood that makes the atonement for the soul. Therefore I say to the Israelites, none of you may eat blood, nor may any foreigner living among you eat blood. Any Israelite or any foreigner living among them hunts down a wild animal or bird that may be eaten. He must drain the blood and cover it with dirt. For the life of all flesh is in the blood. Therefore I told the Israelites, you must not eat the blood of any living thing, because the life of all flesh is in the blood. And whoever eats it must be cut off. Again, so the life is in the blood. Deuteronomy 12:22-24. Indeed, you may eat it as you eat the gazelle or deer, but ceremonially unclean. But both the ceremonially unclean and the clean may eat. Only be sure not to eat the blood, because blood is the life. You must not eat the life with the meat. So it just, again and again, the life, the blood is the life. So you must not eat the life with the meat. You must not eat the blood, nor lay on the ground with blood. Do not eat it, so that it may go well with you and your children after you, because you will be doing what is right in the eyes of the Lord. And getting to the New Testament, and it goes back, referring back to the Old Testament, but it's Hebrews 9:1-22, and it's long. It says, now the first covenant had regulations for worship, and also an earthly sanctuary. A tabernacle was prepared in its rooms, the lampstand, the table, and the consecrated bread. This was called the holy place. Behind the second curtain was a room called the most holy place, containing the golden altar of incense, the gold-covered ark of the covenant inside the ark with the gold jar of manna, Aaron's staff that had budded, the stone tablets of the covenant, above the ark of the cherubim of glory, and overshadowed the mercy seat. But we cannot discuss these things until not everything had to be prepared in this way. The priests entered into the first room to perform their sacred duties, but only the high priest entered into the second room, and then only once a year, and never without the blood which he offered for himself and for the sins of the people, since the people had committed in ignorance. By this arrangement, the Holy Spirit was showing the way that the most holy place had not yet been disclosed as long as the first tabernacle was still standing. It is an illustration of the present time, because the gifts of the sacrifice being offered were unable to clean the conscience of the worshiper. They consist only of food and drink and special washings, external regulations imposed until the court. Before, the priest could not enter the holy place without the blood. It's important. The blood, I mean, I didn't get all this. The blood is the life. It's life. And, when Christ came as high priest of the good things that have come, he went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not made by hands and not part of this creation. He did not enter by the blood of goats or calves, and entered the most holy place of all, for all, by his own blood, securing eternal redemption. The blood of bulls and goats and ashes from heifers sprinkled on those who were ceremonially unclean sanctified them so that their eyes were clean. How much more than the blood of Christ, who was through the eternal Spirit, offered himself unblemished to God. Purify your consciences from your works of death, so that you may serve one another. Therefore, Christ is the mediator of the new covenant, so that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance. Now that because a will does not take effect until the one who made it died. It cannot be executed while he is alive. That is why the first covenant was not put into effect without the blood. When Moses proclaimed the commandment of the law to all people, he took the blood of calves and goats along with water, scarlet wool, and hyssop. Sprinkled the straw, people say, this is the blood of the covenant, which God has commanded you to keep. In the same way, he sprinkled the blood of the tabernacle and all the vessels of worship, according to the law. In fact, nearly everything must be purified by blood, and without shedding blood, there's no forgiveness. A lot of stuff. I just don't like to go off with wild hair and say something that people go, what was that about? And I'm sorry, I haven't done much, but I thought it was important. So, what's so, what's so important about the blood? Why was the blood shed for Jesus? And what that was saying, why the blood? And today's message is lifeblood, but the life is in the blood. And this is the message that God gave me, I don't know, sometimes last week. Of course, just like I said, doing my devotions, and it came. So I'm going to give it to you pretty much as close as I can to what he gave it to me. Without the blood, the human body cannot live. And I know this from facts. The blood carries oxygen, it carries nutrients, it carries waste, it nourishes your body. Every cell, every part of your body is nourished by the blood. And it carries off waste from waste. When your heart stops, it doesn't move blood along. But stopping the heart doesn't kill you. Moving the blood can kill you. Waking my eyes up. You can live. You can have a perfectly good heart, your brain, heart, all the rest of your body can be perfect. But if you're in an accident or something and you get something slit and you bleed out, you're dead. The life of the individual is in the blood. And the nursing, why I didn't get this, I don't know, but I didn't get it, and I guess I'm trying to help you understand. You can't live without the blood, and the blood is so precious to God. We use that as the thing to make everything work as far as life. The little critters, the little bugs, they have some kind of fluid, blood-like fluid, flowing through them. Everything has blood, and the blood is the thing that gives them life. I'm bad about chewing stuff. In the garden, when Adam and Eve sinned, they said, oh, we're naked. They didn't know they were naked until they sinned. And God said, I got to put you out of the garden. I can't leave you here. But he killed an animal, or animals, you can say, and shed the blood of those animals to take the skin to cover them. But it was the blood. The animals had to die. The blood had to be shed to cover the sin. And that was the first example that we have of blood being shed to cover sin. And the next one is, we see Cain. And he got jealous over Abel's sacrifice being more acceptable to God than his was, and he killed him. And God said, your brothers, because Cain said, I don't know what happened to him. Am I his brother's keeper? And God said, your brother's blood cries out from the ground to me. Your brother's life, which is God, cries out to me. So it's the blood. up to the crosses. Wonderful person. He was a person. Was literally beaten unmercifully, unrecognizable. And yeah, he had a little blood spill out here and there. But the majority of his blood was still in his body. He was nailed up there on the cross and hanging there. And when he took his last breath and died, the price, and I thought, my simple mind, that that was the thing that did it. But it wasn't. Had the Roman soldier not gone up, took that, there it is, spear, helped him, probably helped him inside this way. The thing goes up, and it either hits the right vessel or the heart, and the blood, the life, Jesus Christ, pours out. So there, in that, is our redemption. And I didn't get it, because we could, you know, nothing but blood. Well, God, that's messy. But the blood is the life. The life of Jesus was poured out right there on the cross for us. And it was not being crucified. It was not being beaten. It was when his blood poured out. That was for our redemption. And without the blood of Christ, we cannot ever be saved. We can believe a lot of things, and we can play around at it, but if we don't accept Jesus as our Lord, we absolutely cannot be saved. You know that's not the right thing to do. And he's always convicting us. showing us what's right and wrong. And when we have accepted Jesus as our Savior, as our Lord, as our Master, as the one who leads and directs our lives, then He is always there. He's always, always there, but He's there at the right hand of the Father saying, you know, this is my son. This is my daughter. They did it. They're sorry. My blood was spilled to cover this. Would you forgive me? Jesus' life, His life was poured out when that blood flowed for forgiveness of our sins. Repentance for the people that don't get it is not just saying I'm sorry. I'm sorry for a lot of things I've done, and I've done them again, and I'm sorry then too. But repentance means trying not to do it again. And I think I said in Sunday school today, we do it again, or I do, again and again and again and again. And finally God cleans that part of me up, and I quit doing it. But it doesn't happen overnight. And the blood of Jesus still covers us because He loves us and because we say, Lord, I'm really sorry. I really didn't need to do that. I really didn't need to do that. But I did. And He covers us. He cleans us and makes us pure. From the beginning, like from the garden to the cross, we see God made a way. He showed the example in the blood sacrifice in the garden, which pointed to the blood sacrifice of the cross, which covers, purifies, makes us holy. Everyone, absolutely everyone. It's available to absolutely everyone. It was the plan God the Father established in the beginning, and that's what it was. It's why it's the blood. And because without the blood, there's no life. And this is in the beginning, but I think kind of not in my head. When we're in Christ, we are to live righteous lives, to be a part of God. Because God cannot accept imperfection. God can't look on sin. You know, Jesus, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, us. Jesus is the mediator between us and God. Because God can't look at the sin. And Jesus, because He is part of humanity, knows and understands and has sympathy because He understands what we say. So He is there in God's right hand interceding for us and saying, Father, my life was poured out on that day to live. But one person here that Jesus didn't have. Not one, not one, not one. Whether you accept Him or whether you don't, the price was paid for your redemption. And you don't have to be redeemed. You don't have to be saved. It's your choice. But the price was paid. And there's no sin that's so big, that's so bad, that you've done so many times that you cannot forgive. Because He loves you, because He prayed the price, we can be forgiven. And yes, we've done it again and again and again. And we don't remember it. We know. But He loves us. We're His children. He loves us. He loves us so deeply. The Bible compares the body of Christ to a bride. And the women dearly, really loves the bride. Christ dearly loves and the body that has come to Him are His precious possessions. that the word says that he will present them to the Father on that day. So we are precious to Christ, and he desires that every one of us come. I ask everybody, saved all of your life, or so deep in sin you can't see the daylight, to look to Jesus. We all need conversion. We need, if we're not saved, we need to be saved. If we are saved, we need to be kept. And the blood of Jesus saves us.